The 4th of July, a day of independence, a time where we remember the sacrifices of our forefathers that fought for the freedom of America. It would also be a day to remember for Minnesota hockey. They made the biggest splash in free agency by acquiring the top two players on the market. The Wild were back on the map again. Signing these men brought about incredible excitement to the region. Little did they know that the Minnesota Wild would also be signing their own death certificate.
Koivu tried to chip it out of the zone! It comes loose to Pominville, who scores!
The date is October 11th, 2000. After over 7 years of waiting, 7 years of being lost in a wilderness of ice, Minnesota finally had an NHL team again. The Minnesota Wild. 1993 was a dark year for hockey in the state. The North Stars, after years of political standoffs and behind-the-scenes turmoil, were moving to Dallas. Think about that. The NHL out of hockey's hotbed for Texas. It was an insult to them. The fans were bitter for years, especially as the Stars won a cup with their former star Mike Modano hoisting Lord Stanley over his head. It was something they never experienced in Minnesota, making the finals twice only to lose in gut-wrenching fashion. Close, but never close enough. The first few years of the Wild were standard hard-working teams under the legendary Jacques Lemaire. The Trappie was known for a great way to mask talent inefficiencies, especially for a fledgling franchise. But once again, they got another taste of glory. The 2003 playoffs. Incredibly gutsy performances against teams they were projected to lose to. Back-to-back overtime wins against the Avalanche, coming back from a 3-1 deficit against the Canucks. Like that wonderful spring of 1991, another miracle run was taking place. A hockey-starved city would have its closure. The Mighty Ducks would put an end to such a fallacy, stuffing them cold as the Wild scored only one goal against a white-hot Jean-Sébastien Jaguar. As tough as these losses were, it was still a great season. Only their third in team history, too. The possibilities for the future were endless. Except, those possibilities never came. There were twinklings of promise, yes, but never anything legitimate. Two trips to the playoffs only to be quashed by the likes of the Avalanche or the Ducks again. Even then, they never had that big piece or two to take them over the top. It felt like they were close, but never close enough. Now times have become desperate for Minnesota. 4 consecutive years without a playoff berth. The prospects in the system were a few years from being ready and their core was aging. Big splashes for guys like Danny Heatley and Devin Setoguchi had failed to move the needle. The team itself was completely irrelevant in the broad landscape of hockey. The only way for the Wild to put themselves on the map was in free agency. The fans were getting restless. The owner was restless. Minnesota needed their savior. Two players came to mind once July of 2012 hit. Zach Parise, an elite first-line winger. A true leader in the locker room. A perennial 30-goal scorer. Minnesota born and bred. Ryan Suter, a shutdown first-pairing defenseman with outstanding offensive instincts. A calming presence on any blue line, his two-way style of game perfect for the new NHL. There would be many Suters pining for their talents. Detroit, Pittsburgh, Philadelphia, Chicago, and a bunch of teams putting them on their wish lists. If they were going to get one of these guys, they would have to pay up. Owner Craig Leopold was eager for the task. Once again, he was getting impatient with the ineffectiveness of his team. He wanted a jolt not just for the fans, but for his own ambitions. After days of waiting and holding their breath, Deus Ex Machina struck the Wild. They didn't just get Parise or Suter. They got both.
On behalf of our organization and fan base, I want to officially welcome Zach Parise and Ryan Suter to the Minnesota Wild and the state of hockey.
July 4th, 2012. A time when the Wild thought they had lost all hope suddenly had dreams of the Stanley Cup. It turned out that those two were eager to play with each other for a very long time. The two prizes of free agency were a package deal. Even Craig Leopold was shocked that they ended up securing both of them. It was a moment that the Wild needed. Validation. Reinvigoration. Optimism. It was the franchise's greatest moment in almost 10 years. What could be the downside of such signings? The devil is in the details. The celebrations roared throughout the state, but then came the terms. 13 years, $98 million each. They had won the day, but at what cost? Over $7.5 million cap hits until they are both in their early 40s. And remember, this is the 2012 salary cap, so the Wild had invested over 20% of their cap for two players. It was a huge gamble, but was it the right one to make? Nothing against the two in question, Suter and Parise are excellent players. The problem is that they aren't franchise-changing talents. They aren't players that can be relied upon as the guy. In their previous spots, they were part of a greater core. Parise had Patrick Elias, Adam Henrique, and Ilya Kovalchuk to aid him. Suter was one piece of a great pairing with Shea Weber. The only way to justify such cap hits was if they were transcendent talents or had a great complementing core around them. Minnesota had nice prospects coming up through the ranks, but now they would have to carry the burden of pushing them over the top. Unfortunately for Minnesota, their prospect core could not. The signings changed the culture of the organization. They brought them back to the status of playoff contender, but they were never fully convincing. The Wild were comfortably slotted in the second tier of teams. Good, but never great. There was always a hitch in their plans. Major goaltending injuries in their first year. Winning playoff series against teams like the Blues and Avalanche only to be stomped into the ground by the class of their conference and the Blackhawks. More injuries. Their upside wasn't as strong as they had hoped. It was only the heights of the second round. Respectable, but never truly feared. Close, but never close enough. The repercussions of those contracts would rear their ugly heads quickly. Thanks to being pushed towards the ceiling of the cap, the Wild could never truly supplement their two marquee signings for a major cup push. The $15 million they owed the two per year always hanging by their necks, especially when they had to assemble a full roster. Let's suppose they were so frustrated by their playoff futility that they choose to start over. Well, they can't do that either. Suter and Parise have no movement clauses, and even if they didn't, who would take on those contracts? Even with eating half of their salaries, it would be a tough sell. And that's not even getting into the recapture penalties if they retire early. Their modest success would prevent them from securing top draft picks and getting the final piece or two that the organization desperately needed to push for the cup. As the years passed and reality slowly setting, greater prices had to be paid. The young prospects back in 2012 were demanding their own ransoms. The ways to maneuver around it hitting ahead during the Vegas expansion draft. Thanks to the many no-movement clauses on the team, players like Matt Dumba and Jonas Brodin were exposed. Minnesota got them to take a nice depth piece in Eric Halla instead. All it cost them was one of their top prospects in Alex Tuch. Marco Scandella, a nice defender, traded off for cap reasons as well. These were just the major ones in a sea of smaller ripples. In many of these cases, you can point back to that fateful day in 2012 as to why they happened. The signings were a Pyrrhic victory. They were supposed to be the beginning of a great era in Minnesota hockey. In reality, the signings doomed them. Not good enough to compete for championships, physically unable to rebuild, strapped to the brink of the salary cap, and now the best years of the contracts are behind them. The Wild are suffering a fate worse than hell. Limbo. Merely stuck biding their time, waiting for the moment they can break free of their perpetual self-imposed punishment. Forever spinning the hamster wheel. Doing everything in their power to try and push forward, yet going nowhere. Thanks to their playoff futility and the gamble backfiring on them, Chuck Fletcher lost his job as GM. His legacy tied in the two contracts, no matter where he goes. As for the two in question, Suter has lived up to his billing. He has solidified the defensive core and is still performing as advertised. Parise is not. Nothing by his own doing, but he has had serious trouble staying on the ice. Despite a renaissance this year, health has been a major concern, and those fears will not subside. Believe it or not, these contracts have only reached the halfway point. The inevitable declines will occur sooner or later. The worst may be yet to come. July 4th, 2012 went from the greatest moment in Wild history to a cautionary tale. The fate of this team after these huge signings will be analyzed and reanalyzed throughout history. In hindsight, Minnesota would only sign Ryan Suter, but remember, those two were a package deal. If they don't sign Parise, then Suter most likely signs elsewhere to join him. Where would the Wild be if this didn't happen? Do they try again under more manageable 8-year contracts after the lockout? Or do they strip it down and try a full rebuild? Who knows if they were the correct answers, but they may have been better than the fate of the Minnesota Wild. Close, but never close enough.
Coming up there are Mia, up back in the net. Scheifele, in front, Kopp almost buried it. Buffalo knows, bullseye! 49 seconds apart in the goals, and the route is on.